change. I just try to hold off a little bit because when you keep doing it over and over, it kind of gets monotonous. Here I go, let's see.
Thank you. welcome each and every one of you here today. And those that are watching by Facebook, we're so honored that you joined us today. And we are all going to be ready to receive from God. Amen? Because He is an awesome God. And when we're gathered together in His name, He's in the midst of us. So we're going to just be ready to receive. And I want to just ask you before I read a scripture this morning to just share this service on your Facebook page. We're wanting to get the Word of God out, amen? Because I think we can all be in agreement that, you know, the Lord's coming soon, amen?
Yes.
So we want the Word of God to get out there to everybody that we can reach. And, you know, everything that we do for God, no matter how small or how big it seems, God counts it, amen? He sees it and He counts it, amen? He puts it on your in your book, what you have done for Him to spread the word, to spread the gospel, and to get that word out to as many people as possible. So if you'll just put this service on your Facebook page, God is writing it down. Amen. He's keeping a record of it today. Praise God. And so I want to just start out this morning reading Psalms chapter 22, verses 25 and 26. And this is the Passion Translation, I think, for the message. It says, here in this great gathering for worship, I have discovered this praise life. I love the praise life, don't you? Amen. And I'll do what I promised right here in front of the God worshipers. Down and outers sit at God's table and eat their fill. Everyone on the hunt for God is here, praising Him. Lift Him up, live it up from head to toe. Don't ever quit. Amen?
Amen.
We'll never stop praising our
Amen.
God.
Amen.
We'll never stop worshiping Him.
Amen.
Because He is great. He is mighty.
Yes.
He is an awesome God.
Amen.
He is worthy of our praises today. Amen?
Yes.
Well, God bless you. This time I'm going to turn it over to the praise and worship team.
Glory.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We're just shouting to our
praise
God.
God.
Power, I'm sitting in darkness, whose love is mine.
gave it all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody shout to the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
He surrounds us.
Amen.
And when we praise him, it tears down enemy walls.
Amen.
The word says so. It may not say it in that exact manner, but he tells us to fight the good fight. So even when stuff is going on, we're the blood-bought are still able to praise him. It's a choice we need to make. It's a choice we always should make. Praise him in the trials and everything that goes on. So when something great happens and you decide to praise him because something great happens, it's not like, well, she only praises me when something good is going on. Let's praise him at all times because he's worthy, amen. This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
Do it again.
This is how I fight my battles.
look like you've been defeated. With everything that is in you, there may be a storm on the inside saying that this is it. You have failed so badly that God has just turned away. The only one he ever turned away from was Jesus hanging on the cross because of all the sins of all the people. And he just turned his back just for a moment. But that was the sacrifice that made it possible for him never to turn away from you. It's our choice to keep pressing on. And even in the tough times, we must continue to press on. He is always, always side. He will not let you down. You may let you down. The enemy may let you down. A family member or a friend may let you down. But Jesus, never, never, never. This is how you fight your battles. You remind the Lord of what he said. You come against the enemy in prayer. You bind him up. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. You don't allow it. You don't allow it. You see it happening. You experience it. But you come against it. And that's how you fight your battle. And you praise. And you praise. And you praise.
Hallelujah.
And it can't last forever. He always says it's for a season. And so it won't continue. You just got to tough it out. But you are a tough people because the blood has saved you. And it's changed you. And on the inside, the Holy Spirit has got you. So you can do all things through Christ and strengthen you. Can we give him a shout this morning?
Glory,
glory, glory. You might be seated. Hallelujah. As everybody's sitting down, say this with me. I will
fight
my battles
with praise.
Well, good morning, Oasis Christian family. It's so good to see everybody in the house this morning. Oh, God gave us a beautiful morning to wake up to. Absolutely. How many of us are grateful for what God has done this week? Hallelujah. Can we say glory to God? Everything that we have has come through the blood of Jesus that was shed for us, that we may now have everything that God had prepared for us when we were knitted together in our mother's womb. And we just have to do like Jesus said and pray this way and call heaven to earth. So at this time, we are going to praise God. We're going to praise him by honoring him with our tithes and our offerings. Because God has been so gracious to do these things for us. And we're going to do the right thing before God. And we have so many things to be thankful for and grateful for. And you know what? We don't owe anything that we have to ourselves. We were bought with a price. We don't even belong to ourselves as Christians. So it shouldn't even be, should I give or should I not give? That shouldn't even enter in. But I'm not here to put condemnation on you. For those of you that don't understand right now what the tithe is, let me just brief you just a moment. It is a covenant between you and God. Yes, it is in the Old Testament. And yes, Jesus came and gave us grace. And yes, Jesus fulfilled the law. But you know what? God tells us to write that law upon our heart. And when he's training us up in the way that we should go by his word, then we follow his word. We don't take anything out. Woe is to the man that changes the word of God, removing anything from it or adding anything to it. So we follow the word of God. But more than that, we're after the love of God's heart. Because we're created in his image, and he is a God who is gracious and loving, and he gave everything to us. Amen. So that we could have life and have it more abundantly.
Amen.
This is our battle money, because it's of the world, and it can control our heart and our mind. It makes us think of ourselves more highly than we ought to when we have lots of it. It makes us think more poorly of ourselves when we don't. And God says that we have everything that we need. If he cares for the sparrows and the little birds, and look how the flowers pop out of hard clay. How many can go past a concrete, you know, a concrete slab and see a flower growing out of it? That's what God does with us. There's nothing too hard or impossible for Him. If He can bloom a flower out of concrete, I think He can do something with us if we'll put it in His hands. I mean, that's just simple truth. You can't look around. Even the world will tell you, you need to save and you need to do this. And they have the world system, or you need to give into here or give into there. Well, you know what? We give into where our things came from. Where does our help come from? It comes from the Lord. We are not, you know, giving to the pastor. We are giving to the family of God where we are fed. And this is where it begins, so that we can go out as a family and give unto others. So let's hold our tithe in our right hand, because we're doing the right thing before God. And repeat after me. Oops. Let's see. Where's the tithe? Wrong one. Okay. All right. As I tithe and give offerings,
as I tithe and give offerings,
I believe and I receive.
I believe and I receive.
Jobs and better jobs.
Jobs and better jobs.
Raises and bonuses.
Raises and bonuses.
Benefits.
Benefits.
Sales and commissions.
Sales and commissions.
Favorable settlements.
Favorable settlements.
Estates and inheritances.
Estates and inheritances.
Interest and income.
Interest and income.
Rebates and returns.
Rebates and returns.
Discounts and dividends.
Discounts and dividends.
Checks in the mail.
Checks in the mail.
Gifts and surprises.
Gifts and surprises.
Finding money.
Finding money.
Bills decreased.
Bills decreased.
Bills paid off.
Bills paid off.
Blessings and increase.
Blessings and increase.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
For meeting all my financial needs.
For meeting all my financial needs.
That I may now have.
That I may now have.
More than enough.
More than enough.
To give unto the kingdom of God.
To give unto the kingdom of God.
And promote the gospel of Jesus Christ.
And promote the gospel of Jesus Christ.
And here at Oasis, we have several ways that you can give into the ministry here. And I want to assure you that we do plant your seeds into good, fertile soil. Soil that is based on the gospel of Jesus Christ. And ways to give are online at paypal.me/Oasis Family Church. We also have https://osvhub.com/Oasis Family Church/giving/funds. As well as text to give, that is 334-274-7885. Or you can go to oasisfamilychurch.net. That's where you'll find us. You can hit the donate button. It'll give you all the ways to give. You can use Cash App. That is a $, and that is Oasis Family Church with no spaces. Or you can come by the church, pick up some postage paid envelopes, or mail them in through Post Office Box 246 Smith Station, Alabama 36877. All right, we are going to have an awesome word this morning. Amen. Praise and worship has got our hearts opened, softened, so that we can receive what God has for us today. An expectant word, so we're going to clear our minds, our ears are open, our hearts are ready to receive, and we're going to welcome in the Holy Spirit, the presence of the Holy Spirit now, as pastors bring the message.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. I know you are ready today. I
Amen.
Feel it in the atmosphere. Amen. Amen. So just
Amen.
Being ready to receive what God has for you. Well, we want to remind you again today that if you will share this service on your Facebook page, and let's all be a part of being used of God today. We all want to be used, don't we?
Amen.
We want God to use us. And so this is one way that you can allow God to use you. Share the Word of God on your Facebook page today, and God takes account. Amen.
Amen.
So we're just so glad to have all of you, and you that are here in the sanctuary, and you watching by Facebook. And be ready to receive what God has for you. Praise God. Amen. Before I turn over to Pastor, I'm going to read
a blessing.
Blessings over you every service. Praise God. But we're going to be confessing over you walking in victory. Amen. And so I declare over you today that you are victorious in life. You are more than a conqueror. the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. Your faith is the victory that overcomes the world. You have the mind of Christ and hold the thoughts, feelings, and purposes of Christ in your heart and mind. And the Holy Spirit, you have the mind of the Holy Spirit today, which is life and peace.
Yes.
You are spiritually minded. You are living the life of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit lives in you and directs you. You have a unction from the Holy Spirit. You have the unction from the Holy One, and you know all things. The Holy Spirit is leading you, guiding you into all truth. He is revealing things to you and showing you things to come. You have been born again of the incorruptible seed of the living Word of God. It abides in you forever.
Amen.
You are strong in the Lord and in the power of His might.
Amen.
You are empowered through the union with Him. You have been created by God to prosper and to make a difference in this world. You are a success. You are the head. You are above only, and you are blessed of God in Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Amen. Praise God.
Yes.
Praise God.
We are
Praise God.
Blessed today, aren't we?
Praise God.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You turn over to Pastor this time.
I love it when you read that blessing.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise
God. I love it. I receive it. Amen.
Yes. Yes.
And praise and worship. Wow.
Wonderful.
Always. I remember thinking about praise and worship. Many, many years ago as we were starting the church. Mm-hmm. And what we have now is what I envisioned then.
Uh-huh.
It took a long time to get here.
Uh-huh.
But that was the instrument that God used and the praise and worship team that we have now. I'm telling you, y'all are flowing. Y'all are taking it to the next level. It is amazing. It is amazing. I thank God for it. Every time I hear them, I thank God for them. I mean it. Okay, it's neighbor looking time, not talking time, so I was talking. Neighbor looking time, point at your neighbor, smile at your neighbor, and say, I came
to receive
God's good word
this day.
And I declare,
I'm ready.
Are you ready
to receive
God's good word
this day?
And I declare,
I'll
never,
never,
ever be the same
again
in Jesus' name. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I just thank you that the eyes of our understanding are enlightened according to the hope of your calling. I thank you for revelation knowledge. I thank you that the word of the Lord will have free course in our midst. I thank you for strong utterance and strong anointing, and that your people receive it this day. They make a strong drawing on the anointing of God. And I declare we receive answers in your presence. We see things we've never seen. We hear things we've never heard. We draw out answers that have nothing to do with what we're hearing today. And also, we draw out answers that have plenty to do with what we're hearing today. We're opened up by the Spirit. The anointing opens us up to answers. We're in that other realm today, the realm of the Holy Spirit. And answers are present all around us this day. Miracles, signs, and wonders are all happening in our lives today. We thank you, Father God, for what you are doing in the rest of this service and in us this day. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I ask if you will to get your Bibles and go to 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse number 33. 1 Corinthians 14 and 33. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. Now, we're teaching about reverence in the Spirit of God today, and I want to define reverence, just a couple of things. Deep respect for someone or something. Regards or treats with deep respect. Now, 1 Corinthians 14 and 40, you can just, it's just a few scriptures from where you're at. This is also in King James. Let all things be done decently and in order. Now, I want to read a scripture in Hebrews 12 and 28 and 29. This is in the Free Bible Version. Since we're receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us have a gracious attitude so that we can serve God in a way that pleases Him. Mm-hmm. We're trying to serve God in a way that pleases Him with reverence and respect. For our God is a fire that consumes. Now, I'm going to start out this morning by telling you, we went to a restaurant the other day. We took Granny out and got her out to eat. And we try to go out at least once a week with Granny just to take her out and just enjoy fellowshipping together. And we were at this restaurant. And when we go to a restaurant, I know y'all, I sound like a broken record, but we always pray over where we're seated, and we pray over favor with the host or hostess, and favor with that there be no turmoil or anything around where we're at. If you're going to spend time and money, you may as well enjoy your time that you're spending and your money that you're spending. You may have a good time, and you understand the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy, so he would love to ruin any time that you have together with your family, or any time it's just going to be a peaceful, wonderful time for you. And that's the reason we cover it in a simple prayer every single time. We forgot. And it is rare for us. And I didn't even think about it. You know, we got to the restaurant. We normally do it on the way to the restaurant. I just completely forgot to cover it. We're sitting down. They'd seated us in this nice place. And then all you start hearing is somebody, and I can't discern where they're speaking. I thought it was the guy that was across from us in the booth on this side. But it wasn't. I noticed I'm watching him very closely, and it's not him. It's somebody on the other side. There's partitions between each booth, so you can't see who's there. And somebody is really loud. I can tell you everything that's going on in their conversation. I can't hear our conversation as good as I can hear their conversation at their table, and there's a wall between us. Wow. You understand, a partition wall. Yeah. And I'm like, man, somebody needs to speak to him. And he did this the whole time. Okay? It's not my business to do it. You understand? I don't have authority in this place. I could have said something, but I didn't. But anyway, I realized, I said, we didn't pray about this. And so, it was a good time. We had great service. It was great food. But it would have been better if this guy had just hushed a little bit, if he had just been a little more quiet. Because part of my praying after we got there was, Father, isn't it time for them to go now? Isn't it time for them to finish their food rather quickly, Father, and leave? Isn't it that time? I believe it's that time. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Okay, now, I said that for a reason. In that restaurant situation, it's easy to see that he was out of order. And it affected things. Right. It affected other people from enjoying their meal, their family time. In a church situation, and there would be ushers that would take care of that. Uh-huh. If somebody got too loud in a service, maybe not meaning to, maybe not realizing to, I don't know about you guys, but plenty of times I've got too loud, didn't realize I was doing it. But the ushers would just tap them on the shoulder and tell them, they're drawing attention away from the Lord, and it's nothing personal. They just that's the usher's job, is to keep order. If somebody's too loud, if they're disturbing service, just tap them on the shoulder in a polite way to make them aware it's affecting people, it's affecting the service. If somebody brought food and drink in the service and they started eating and drinking while the preaching is going on, I mean, they're passing a bucket of fried chicken. And you understand, they've got KFC or whatever you like. They've got, okay, Popeyes. And they got the red beans and rice, the Popeyes. They got the apple pie. Never mind, I understand. Okay, I got you all hungry now. Okay, and they're passing it around on their row, and they're eating and drinking. How many of y'all, you recognize that would be out of order, right? Yeah. That would not be in order. And you would recognize the usher is going to tap somebody on the shoulder, and we're going to get a chicken out of here. You understand? It's going to have to go. You understand? Because it's not in order. Okay, if you started clipping your nails while you're supposedly listening to the service, can you see that would probably not be a good thing? Okay, so the usher again would tap you on the shoulder because it's his job to keep order. But if you started coughing, the usher would bring you a cough drop or some water. You know, they minister to your needs to keep order. 1 Corinthians 14:33, again, God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. Now, I want you to remember, we're going to say this one over and over, but confusion in any place, I'm not speaking just of the church when I'm saying this particular thing, confusion opens the door to the devil. If there's confusion on your job, it's opening the door to the devil. There's a bunch of strife, there's a bunch of, you know, backbiting and gossip and all this kind of junk, and you kind of, you're trying to be pulled into the drama. I'm telling you, that's confusion, and it's not of God. Stay away from it. It'll mess you up. It'll get you goofed up. It'll affect things. It'll affect things in the atmosphere around you.
Amen.
That was good.
Yes, it was. Amen.
Okay, now let's go back to the church situation. We don't have this in this church. I'm not preaching this because we've got this. You know, a lot of people say, "Well, you must have had that. That's the reason you're preaching it." It's not. It's to never happen. That's the reason the Lord gives it to me from time to time to preach, so we won't have it. There have been services in churches where the pastor is preaching, and somebody comes up to the podium while the man is preaching and is trying to argue with the man while he is preaching, talking to him, fussing at him, and just causing a confusion, and the anointing lifts. Can you understand that wouldn't be godly? It wouldn't be God. It would be the devil. We can all see that. It would be out of order. Anything that causes confusion is out of order. It's never backed by God. Okay? God is never the author of it. If somebody says, "Well, God told me to go up there and correct him, that pastor, that preacher, that teacher, whoever it is, while they're up there," he did not. You're lying. Because that was somebody told you, but it was the devil that told you. Because he is the author of confusion. God is not. God would never prompt somebody to bring confusion. Okay? Now let me put it on a different level where you can see it more clearly. If the same thing, if I went into a restaurant, I went into their kitchen, I interrupted their chef, I tapped him on the shoulder, and I said, "You're not making that meal right. I don't like it. You need to fix it the way my grandmama fixed it. You need to stop that right now. You understand? You need to stop. Let me show you how to do it." I would create confusion in that kitchen. You know what they do? They throw me out. I'll leave it right there for a second. I found scripture after scripture telling me that if somebody comes in a congregation of people, I'm not even going to bring it out this morning. If somebody came in a congregation of people and they were maliciously, you understand there's a difference between somebody doing something out of ignorance and being out of order, or somebody doing something maliciously, repeatedly maliciously. If somebody, there's a specific thing in the Word of God that says, if they keep coming and they keep coming and they keep coming over and over, and you showed them that they're out of order and they're just trying to cause division and stuff, they're trying to argue the Bible or whatever, we don't believe like you believe, and they're just over and over causing disturbances in the body.
That's right.
Then after you've corrected them over and over and over and over, it says then put them out.
Amen. That's right.
That means, it says put them out. You're not letting them back in the door. You're telling them, you know, if you can, you know, be nice, you can come back. But if not, you're going to have to stay outside the door. Because you can't have confusion when people are trying to receive from God. It stops us all from receiving. Can you see that? Okay. Many years ago, I was in a service, and the pastor was preaching, and there was a message in tongues that came forth in the service, but it came forth while he's ministering. You say, "Well, maybe there was a lull in the service," and that would be perfectly correct. It would be. If there's a lull, that would be a perfect opportunity for a message in tongues to be delivered. That's right. That's decently and in order. But it wasn't. He was still speaking. And while he's speaking, this message rises up three or four times, and this person interrupts and gives this message to the congregation. Okay, I'm not saying the message wasn't from God. I'm saying that the person that was used by the gift of the Spirit was immature.
That's right.
And they didn't know where to place the message.
Yeah.
That there should have been placed at a lull in the service, should have been placed at the end of the service. Maybe it wasn't even for that service. Maybe it was for the next service. Even though they got that word now, you know, the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. A lot of people say, "Well, I couldn't help it. It was God." You can help it. You can control it.
Uh-huh.
Oh, you almost missed it.
That's true.
I can hear the turn back. Okay, there's a time for everything, and there's a perfect time. Even though it's a message coming from God, okay, a man was ministering, and this message came forth from God. Why would God interrupt himself? He's already ministering and giving the word. God's word is coming forth. God would not interrupt himself. Can you see that? So the message was just given at a wrong time. And what it does is it plays in. We never had this. It plays into creating confusion, which the devil likes. He thrives on confusion because he's the author of confusion, and it causes all kind of junk, all kind of problems, all kind of evil works come in. So now let's keep digging down. Can we dig a little more?
Yeah.
So if we're going to reverence the Spirit of God in a service, I wouldn't talk unnecessarily when the service is going or too loud. Did I say you couldn't talk during the service? That's not what I'm saying. You might be talking to your loved one or whatever, but I wouldn't be talking about what I'm going to have for lunch. You might make a comment about what's going on, you know, what that meant to you. That, wow, that's amazing. But you wouldn't be talking about natural things.
Yes.
Soulish things. Can you get it? Because you're out of the spirit, and you say, well, it's just me and my loved one. No, it's not. It's the whole congregation of people, and it affects the spirit. The Holy Spirit will lift so fast, our heads will swim. The Holy Spirit, when he's interrupted, when he's not paid attention to the way he should be. Can you grasp what I'm saying? I mean, there's a holy reverence. Somehow, this generation of people has lost the holy reverence for God that they used to have in the great revivals and stuff. One of the common denominators of all the great revivals and all the great moves of God was they had a holy reverence for God. They were afraid. When I say afraid, I'm talking about they having a reverential fear for moving unnecessarily, for talking unnecessarily, for speaking out when they didn't know if they should speak out or not. I can guarantee you they wouldn't be on their cell phone. Hang on. Well, I got that call. Yeah, I'm in the church. Yeah. Yes, it's pretty good. It's all right. Yeah. It's been better, actually. I don't get what I used to get. You know why you don't get what you used to get? Because you're not paying attention. Because if you're drawing, God's got something for you. I don't care who it is. I don't care if there's a donkey up here behind this thing. God can have that donkey bray in such a way you're going to receive what you need to receive.
Amen.
I heard Marilyn Hickey say one time that she's ministering. She's teaching in the basement of her house. And she said that, you know, she's teaching or whatever. And it's going out on the radio and it's going everywhere. And she said there was this cricket. She couldn't get this cricket stopped from making that cricket chirping noise while she's doing it, and it just ruined her thing. She's upset about it, you know, and then the thing goes out and the cricket's on it. And said that she got a letter back, and it was from an inmate at one of the prisons. He said, you ministered to me so much when I heard the cricket. Because I hadn't heard a cricket in so long. I've been in this place for so long. It let me know that God was just telling me I love you by that cricket. God can use anything. Okay, now, I got to qualify this. Because when I say you wouldn't talk unnecessarily, there are reasons that you have to speak. You're doing your duties. You're doing other things. When I say you wouldn't move around unnecessarily, well, you got to go to the bathroom. I'm just saying you wouldn't do it unnecessarily.
Uh-huh.
You understand?
That's right. That's right.
Thank you very much. Doing your duties in the church. Sometimes it's a lack of respect, and it creates confusion.
Right.
A lack of reverence for the Spirit of God. I've been in services where the gifts of the Spirit were in operation in a great way, and the man of God that was leading the service said, okay, If the word of wisdom, word of knowledge is in operation tonight, he said, and the word of wisdom is for people with backs. And I call you down for people with backs. And this was the man of God, and he was speaking. He said, don't come down if there's something wrong with your foot. Only come down if there's something wrong with your back. Don't come down to have hands laid on you when the gifts of the Spirit are in operation like that for a greater anointing. I'm telling you, I sat right beside people that have said, you know what? Something was called out. You know what? I'm going to go down and I'm going to get hands laid on me for a greater anointing. And I'm thinking, oh, man. I'm thinking, you dense?
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry. That's what I was thinking. Maybe y'all wouldn't have thought. Amen. Y'all wouldn't have thought of such a... Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm thinking if you just listen to the man, he might, by the Spirit of God, the God might lead him to call out what's bothering you in your foot. What's bothering you? He might call you out to lay hands on you for a greater anointing in your life. He might be led to, however, but you got to give the control of that to the Spirit of God, not take it. Because there again, the Holy Spirit will lift. I believe one of the reasons we're teaching this today is because we're going to go in a deeper level than we've been before, and we're going to see more signs, wonders, and miracles. We're going to see more answered prayer than we've ever seen, because we're going to be able to reverence the Spirit of God in a greater way than before.
Hallelujah.
I'm coming to a close. 1 Samuel 2 and 30 in the BBE translation, that's the Bible Basic English translation. And I will give honor to those whom I am honored, and those who have no respect for me will be of small value in my eyes. So we need to respect the things of God. Okay, I'll give you another little side journey if I can.
Yes.
Gloria Copeland said that the Spirit of God showed her one time, and I believe I've got this right. I believe it was Gloria. It might have been Ken, but I believe it was Gloria. I think I know Gloria was telling it. And she was saying that the Lord showed her that, you know, their ministry is huge. And just like all these bigger ministries, they've got tapes and they've got, you know, books. And they've got the tape tables and the book tables and all the stuff set up in their foyers of those churches. So that, you know, after the service, people can, you know, buy the materials or whatever. And she said the Spirit of God told her, said that, I don't want you opening those tables until this service is completely done. Uh-huh. It's not reverencing my spirit by doing this when I'm not through doing what I was doing. Uh-huh. And it's going to create, see, he was implying there's going to be a confusion there, because some people are going to say, I'm getting to that table before that line gets there.
That's right.
Is this what we do?
Uh-huh.
And they're going to leave out of the service. But yet God was doing something in the service with people that were being, hands were being laid on them. God was doing an amazing thing. He had other things to do, but he couldn't finish it, because by opening those book and tape tables, they didn't do it maliciously or for the wrong reason. They didn't understand. It was grieving the Spirit of God by them doing that.
Amen.
Can you understand what I'm saying? So they stopped doing it. It was being disrespectful to the Lord. There again, 1 Corinthians 14:33. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. 1 Corinthians 14:40. Let all things be done decently and in order. Pastor Sharon.
Praise
God. Praise
God.
Line as pastor was ministering, and I'm going to be starting in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 27, and this is the King James. I'm going to be reading that also in the Passion Translation. It says that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that it should be holy and without blemish. And so, all that the Lord does for us is for our good. And the Passion Translation says, all that he does in us is designed to make us a mature church for his pleasure, until we become a source of praise to him, glorious and radiant, beautiful and holy, without fault or flaw. And that's where the Lord is leading us to, amen. So that we are a glorious church. He is coming back for a glorious church. Amen.
And you know, he's coming, and I say this all the time, a lot, because it's so true. The Lord is coming back soon. Amen.
Yes.
So he's getting his church ready. Amen. He's getting us prepared. He's getting us in line. Amen. But you know, I wanted to read some of the words that mean glorious in the dictionary. Means wonderful, marvelous, magnificent, spectacular, excellent, divine. Amen. God is creating us, amen, into his perfect church, his glorious church. And so, you know, the last couple of years or so, you know, the church has been going through a lot. The world has been going through a lot,
amen.
But the church has also.
Amen.
But, you know, I can't say that it's completely over. I want to say with everything within me, you know, wants to say, be able to say that everything's over with. But, you know, the enemy's always trying to throw stuff out there. But, you know, the church, God always takes care of his church. Amen. And I have to say that God has been good to Oasis Christian Center. Amen. He has taken care of Oasis. And God is God no matter what's going on in the world. Amen. No matter what kind of a disease the enemy might come up with, no matter what kind of financial situation the enemy might come up with, God is God, and he's going to take care of his people. He doesn't change just because there's an issue going on in the world. He is still the same. He is the same powerful God as he ever was, amen, and he will always be. Praise God. But you know, I know that God has a plan for his church. He has a great plan for his people.
Yes, he does.
And he is going to take great care of his people. Now, I'm going to bring out a few things that might, I don't want you to think, oh no, you know, I don't want you to think I need to be afraid or dread or anything. Because, but I heard this preacher the other day, and it was on Sid Ross, and I didn't get his name, to be honest. I've seen him on there before. He's a very reputable preacher. I think he's actually from overseas. But he said that the Lord had told him that the world is going through a reset.
Yes.
And I heard what's his name? Kuhneman, Hank Kuhneman. He is a pastor, and he is a well-known prophet. And I heard him say that the world's going through, globally, a reset. And so, you know, God is doing something. He is still God, isn't he? He is still on the throne, amen? We're still his people. He's still taking care of us. But he said that the world is going through a reset, that everything will be broken down in order for a reset. And you know, when things go out in your home, I know for us, everything in our house is computerized, or, you know, Wi-Fi and all this stuff. And so if the electricity goes out, we have to reset everything in the house.
Yeah.
You know? And so that's what a reset is, amen? And so there's that reset even in the church, but praise God, you know, God is the head of this church, and he is taking care, amen?
Yes,
he is taking care of the church. Us personally, Oasis Christian Center, you personally, God has taken care of you, amen?
Yes,
hallelujah. Some of you have even gotten in a better position since COVID,
yes.
You know? And then he went on to say, and the church is about to step over into days of power.
Yes.
Great news. He said, days of power, more anointing, and more glory. The gifts of the Spirit are going to intensify, and we're going to experience true revival. And you know, I think that's what the Lord is saying today.
Amen.
You know, he is leading his church into a great revival. I believe that with all my heart. God is getting his church ready. Amen. He has not forgotten his people. He has not forgotten his bride. Amen. We are a glorious church, and God is taking care of us.
Amen.
Also, at the first of the year, I heard the prophecy that was given to Jerry Savelle for 2022. And, you know, Jerry Savelle is one of my very favorite preachers. And the Lord always, at the beginning of each year, is actually at the end of the year, concerning what the Lord's vision is, or what his, you know, he's planning on doing in his church for the next coming year, So the Lord gave this to Jerusalem for 2022. He said, if my people will not be shaken or moved by all the chaos and disorder that's taking place in the world around them, I will open my hand unto them and cause them to experience supernatural, extraordinary, and unusual provision. I love that. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. I receive it. Glory to God. If you receive it, it can be yours. Yes. See, we're not going to look at the natural. We're not going to look at what's going on in the world. Amen. We've got our eyes focused on the Lord. He is going to give us the provision that we need. Amen. He's given us everything that we need. So there again, no matter what's going on, God has a plan for his people. He has a great plan for his church. Amen?
Amen.
I heard Nessie Dufresne in one of her messages. She was talking about Kenneth Hagin. And she said Kenneth Hagin had made a statement. He said, when reverence and honor are restored, there will be a restoration and multiplication of the miraculous power of God. Amen? So, you know, I don't know about you, but I love the miraculous power of God. And I know you do too, amen. I know you do. So, you know, I want to be right in the middle of what God's doing. I want to be right in the middle of God moving in the miraculous, amen. I want to see his power moving. And so I want to reverence the Lord, amen. But, you know, we've got to give place to that miraculous power in order to see it move, amen? In order to see the miraculous power of God moving, we've got to give reverence to that. We've got to give place to that. We've got to invite that in, amen?
Amen.
And, you know, the greater reverence and the reverence and the greater honor that we give God, the greater miraculous power of God will see in operation and will see in manifestation. Mm-hmm. Amen. So we want to be even more aware, you know, of giving place to the Holy Spirit and what he wants to do, to the presence of God. So reverence and honor opens the door to heaven.
Uh-huh.
It opens it to move and to minister and to do what God wants to do. And so, you know, reverence, so the opposite of that is, you know, irreverence and dishonor closes the door to heaven. It closes the door to what God wants to do. I know I need God for a lot of things, don't you? I know you do too, amen? And so I don't want to do anything that's going to close the door to heaven. Praise God. And, you know, we want to come in these services, amen, and we want to invite heaven to be wide open for us, don't we? So we got to set the atmosphere for the presence of God. We've got to set that atmosphere with reverence and honor, amen? And that's what Pastor was talking about. We can't come in here with just, you know, chicken on our mind. We got to put that aside, amen? And we can't be talking to each other. Where are we going to go after church? I want to go get some chicken. I'm hungry too, people. Wanda was talking about tomatoes Wednesday night. I was like, I love me some tomatoes. Glory to God. Did I just go there? Okay. Forgive me, Lord. Back to reverence and honor. Amen. But I want to be sure when I come into the services, when I come here, I want to come in with God on my heart. Amen. I want to come in setting the atmosphere for the presence of God, for his miraculous power to operate, for him to have free course to do what he wants to do in every service. Amen. So, you know, I want to come in the services with God on my heart. Amen. And I want to come in with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords on my heart. Amen. I want to come in and just be ready for what the Spirit of God wants to do in that service, how he wants to move. Allow him to have his way, amen? Not just my way, you know, I've got my own thing, I'm concerned about myself. Uh-huh. No, we've got to come in ready for what God wants to do in every service.
Amen.
Be ready, amen? But, you know, I don't want to come in just for myself. I don't want, you know, I want to prefer my brother and sister also. You know, I want to come in with the right attitude and want to set the atmosphere because the my brothers and sisters have need, amen? They've got some needs. Sometimes it's serious needs. Sometimes it's a matter of life and death. You know, we don't know what other people are going through.
That's right.
You know, so we've got to consider each other. I need to be in a frame of mind of worship. Amen.
Yes.
A frame of mind of inviting the Holy Spirit in. Amen. To inviting God's presence that He can do that miraculous power that He wants to do.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Even even the preaching of the word, you might be preaching on one thing, but when people are drawing and being reverent and honoring the presence of God, God can speak something directly to you. That will completely give you revelation in the area that you are needing in your life. I mean, God can move in such a way. And so when we're here, we all need to be considerate of that, don't we? You know, just realize when we come in that God is going to minister. He wants to minister personally. He wants to minister as a group, but He wants to minister personally. He wants to speak directly to your need. Amen. But you know, I know that if I come in here and I've got everything else on my mind, Pastor and I have been disagreeing on the way to church. You know, we've got all this stuff going on. You know, I'm not coming in inviting the atmosphere of God to be in
here.
That's
right.
You know?
That's right.
We've got to be respectful.
Yes.
Honor.
Yes.
Reverence. Yes. Invite the presence of the Lord in. I don't want to in any way quench the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
I don't want to in any way grieve the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. But I want to give the Holy Spirit full access to move in the miraculous power. Amen. Do what He wants to do in the service. You know, we think, I'm just coming to church on Sunday morning, giving God that hour of time or whatever. Amount of time it is. But no, we're coming here. We're coming here to worship the Lord.
Yes.
We're coming here to honor Him.
Yes.
Amen. And we're coming here to receive what God has for us. You know, we're going to receive in here. We're not going to receive at work or even at home a lot of times, you know. I'm not saying it could never happen, but I'm saying when you come into the services, the Spirit will move much stronger, amen, than it will anywhere else. So we want to be mindful of being reverent, mindful of being showing honor to God when we come into the service. But God is getting us ready, amen. He's getting us ready for that great end-time revival, praise God. And we all want to be a part of that, don't we? Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's give God a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Can we just pray the Spirit for a minute? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Praise you. I just plead the blood of Jesus Christ over each and every person today, Father God, that are here in this sanctuary, those that are watching my Facebook, Father God. You see every need, Father. You see those, Lord God, that are down, Father God, that are going through hard situations, Lord God. I speak your peace over them, Father. I ask you, Father God, to touch them in every situation in their lives, Father God. Minister to them, Father God, at their need, Father God. We thank you, Father God, that your power, Father God, your miracle-working power flows to them, Father God, by your Spirit, Lord. It touches them and ministers them and gives them that touch that they need today. I speak encouragement over each and every one in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father God, for your encouragement. going out, Father God, and touching each and every person, Father God, just by discouragement in Jesus' name. I bind it in the name of Jesus. Discouragement has to go. Hallelujah. Your answer is drawing close to God. That is the answer, drawing close to God. Hallelujah. Because He is able. He is able. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I plead the blood of Jesus Christ over people who are sick in their bodies, those that are suffering and with pain in their bodies. I bind pain in the name of Jesus. I command pain to leave your body in Jesus' name. I call forth healing in your body in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Healing power has gone out. It has gone out. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise you. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory. Let's just pray for a minute. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody's going through a work situation. I thank you, Father God, that you just move and minister, Father God, in that work situation, Father God, that you make the crooked places straight, Lord God, that you work this out, Father God, for their good. And we bind the enemy that's trying to cause a problem on the job in the name of Jesus. We break the power of that assignment in Jesus' name. We declare in the name of Jesus that that assignment can no longer work against them. It is bound in Jesus' name.
Yes. Jesus.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. God is good. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Thank you so much for joining us here at Oasis for this service today. And just ask that the Lord go with you through this week and bless you, lead, guide, and direct you in the name of Jesus. We'll see you Wednesday night at 7 o'clock.
Amen.